Well, good morning, Deerfield Road family. Let me try that again. Maybe y'all aren't awake. Good morning, Deerfield Road family. Hey, it's good to be in God's house with you on today. And for those that are joining us online, this is Deerfield Road, and I'm Pastor Ed, and this is what we do. We worship the Lord Jesus. I'm a pastor's kid, and one of the things that is, yes, thank you, continue praying for me. But when you're a pastor's kid, there's a lot of things that you think about, a lot of emotions that go through your mind. And I just want to take a moment. This has nothing to do with my sermon. It has to do with being family. So guys, when we do the edit, you can take this out. But as a pastor, you care for your campus in such deep ways. And today we have the opportunity to be able to celebrate a couple of our staff that are transitioning, Jen and also Pastor Jason Akers. And I just want to take a moment. We've already had an opportunity to be able to share a little bit, but I just want to take a moment just to respond and give God thanks for Jason and Terry and the family and Jen. By just our applause, just being able to say thank you guys so much for the ways that you care for this church. I have the incredible task of sharing God's word in the midst of competing emotions. And for many of us, there's sadness, there's joy, there is pause of God, what is next? And one of the things that I love about the word of God is the word of God settles us. It gives us perspective. And this morning, we are going to be in John chapter 4. And I want to invite you to grab a Bible or take your neighbor's if you don't have one. It's okay. And go to John chapter 4. And I have the ungodly privilege to try to preach an entire chapter today, starting with the 7th verse going to the 42nd verse. But before we even go that far, I want to pause and ask the Lord to be with me. Because the reality is we need God. We need his word. And it's because of his word that we're even here. So if you would, just bow your heads with me for a moment as we get into the word today. Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to preach your word. Thank you, Lord, that there is nothing new under the sun. And in fact, Lord, you know everything. And so we submit to you our brokenness, our weakness. But you said that where we are weak, you are made strong. And so we stand in that strength even now as we preach your word. Give us clarity and give us refreshment in Jesus' name. Amen. Summertime is an awesome time in the world of church, and especially here in Chicago, because there's just so many things that you can do to refresh yourself. And I don't know about you, going through a school year and maybe even a season of work, isn't it nice just to be refreshed? Just spend some time refreshing. You know, there's a few hundred thousand of my friends that are down near my house right now being refreshed at Lollapalooza. And they're being refreshed in a lot of different ways, some that we don't talk about in church on Sunday morning. But refreshment is something that we all need and something that we all desire. A few weeks ago, the Lord provided refreshment to me in a way that is rather unusual. There's a young man by the name of Sam who came to church, and Sam was sitting in the back with his mother, and he had a stocking cap on, and I remember seeing Sam about a year and a half ago. Many of you know that it's hot in Chicago in the summer, so if someone comes into church with a stocking cap, you may want to have a conversation. You may want to just check and see what's going on. And Sam was sitting there with his mother, and he came up after the service, and he said, "Pastor Ed, I just wanted to introduce myself. This is the first time that I've been to church. I heard that you were preaching, and I had to come because we were walking down the street, and we saw Harvest Bible Chapel. I've never been here. I don't know anything about the church, but I came, because tomorrow I'm having brain surgery. See, for many of us, we got up this morning and we didn't feel any pain, and we got dressed in the outfit that we thought made us look sexy and good before the Lord, and put on that outfit and came to church ready to be able to give God glory in some manner. But Sam was a little different, because Sam has had double-digit numbers of surgeries on his brain. And he was going to Northwestern Hospital to have yet another surgery. And he said, "Pastor Ed, I just wondered if you could pray for me." In that moment, everything stands still in church. In that moment, all the stuff that was going on afterwards that needed to be done, it all stood still, because in that moment, Sam needed to be refreshed by the Lord. And he would ask a sinner like me, who had just shared the word of God, to be able to pray for him that he would have strength to go through surgery. Have any of you ever been in that place where you needed to ask? Thank you. You've been in that place where you've asked God for refreshment. And last week, as ministered and I got up, guess who was in the audience with his mother? It was Sam. And guess who made his way through the crowd afterwards to come and give me a hug and let me know that he was doing all right and he was getting ready to go into yet another surgery, but that God was still God and that he needed prayer as he went for that operation. What does it mean for you to need refreshment today? I'm going to spend a few minutes talking about what does it mean to be refreshed by living water in John chapter 4. And we're going to pick up the story in verse 7, but before we read the text, and I'm not going to read all of it together in one setting, so you don't have to worry about that. We'll make our way through it. But I want to share a little bit of context, because if you don't have the context of John chapter 4, you can't appreciate what's really happening. See, Jesus was at a well, and this was early in his ministry. Jesus, in the city, we say the block is hot. When there's trouble around, the block is hot. And the block had become hot because Jesus had been baptizing and bringing so many people to Christ. But in actuality, Jesus didn't baptize anyone. His disciples baptized them. And so the text lets us know that Jesus had to leave because the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was doing more acts than John the Baptist. There's always haters in our lives that are there to just take record of what's going on and keeping track sometimes of things in our lives. And in this time, it was the Pharisees. And Jesus, knowing that, realized that he needed to leave Judea and start to make his way toward Galilee, which was in the north. But the Bible says in verse 4 that he had to pass through Samaria. For some of us that have studied this passage before, you know that that's a half-truth. Jesus didn't have to pass through Judea. There's actually a couple ways that he could have gone. And for Jews, most Jews, because they didn't like Samaritans, which we'll get to in a moment, they would go around Samaria. And they would take the road less traveled. And they would go around to avoid Samaritans. Well, Ed, why did they do that? Well, thank you, Quentin. I'm glad you asked. I want to share a little bit about that, because the Bible says that he went through a town called Sychar. And Sychar is a very important city, not just in this story, but in the Bible. But ironically, this is the only place that it's mentioned in Scripture. Sychar was a significant city. It's where Jacob actually had purchased this land and settled his family. In your free time this week, if you want to read Genesis chapter 33, around the 18th verse, we start to see how Jacob bought this land and settled it for his family. But it gets even better as you read Genesis. You find out that Joseph, after the children of Israel were in exile, he said, if you can,
If we ever get out of this place that's in exile, would you bring my bones back and bury me here? And they did. It was in Sychar. But Abraham and Isaac also built altars there and worshiped the Lord Jesus. So this was a very, very important place if you were a Jew and in Israel at that time. But what's interesting is something happened in history around 722 BC. This area was actually invaded by the Assyrians. And the Assyrians took 20,000 prisoners. They couldn't even round up enough. They took 20,000 prisoners back home. But they left many of the people there. And then they came and they merged with the children of Israel and had children and introduced idolatry. And so many of the people who were Jews saw this area as mixed-raced dogs. I'm being polite in church in the morning because you don't understand the hatred that existed between Jews and Samaritans. Parenthetically, prayed this morning and asked the Lord Jesus to be with the people of El Paso. Someone went to church this morning and didn't have a family member with them. All because the heinous sin of hatred that so permeates so much of our society and so much of our culture and so much of our cities and our rural areas and all around the world. We pray for the people of El Paso, and I ask that you would be in prayer with me as we pray for them and those of our brothers and sisters that are of Latin descent that have experienced this. I thought it was interesting that the Lord Jesus would allow me to see that and see the hatred that's also in this text, because it gives you the context of what's happening at this well. This isn't just any well. In Palestine, this well was the deepest physical well that we see recorded in Scripture. And the Bible lets us know in verse 6, before we get to our text, that Jesus was weary. Any of you guys ever been weary? Yeah. Some of you might be weary right now. And I didn't even want to come to church. I just came because the person sitting next to me made me come. That's the reason why I'm here. I really don't want to even listen to you right now. I'm weary. I'm weary, and I don't know what to do. Maybe that's you. Jesus understands what it means to be weary, and the Bible lets us know that Jesus went to the well and was just chilling. The Bible lets us know that this was about the sixth hour, which most historians believe it's around noon. So Jesus is here. He's waiting and weary. And he had sent the disciples into town to get some Chick-fil-A. I just love how Jesus is. You know, I'm not going to go all the way in town. Brothers, would y'all go and get some brothers some food? I mean, just all of you. 12, how many men does it take to go get lunch? I don't know. But for some reason or another, all the disciples went. And Jesus, the Bible lets us know, says he was alone at the well. And sister girl comes up about noon. We have a problem, ladies and gentlemen. We have a major problem. Hold the phones. Jesus is beginning to act a little rogue. Jesus, the Savior of the world, doesn't understand the moral fences. Jesus is getting ready to cross. He's getting ready to do something that's going to keep us all on our edge of our seats, because Jesus talks to a single woman. See, I'm downtown at the cathedral, and I have a lot of millennials, and I'm trying to get a lot of single guys to talk to some single women. Amen? I mean, I don't have a problem. You need to talk to her. She's right here, bro. Go and say hello. Jesus doesn't have a problem talking to this single woman, but it's quite scandalous, and it wasn't about dating. I believe that Jesus went through Samaria precisely for this moment. And that's where we pick up the text. I'm going to read verse 7 through 15. A woman from Samaria came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." We're going to work with Jesus on his manners. He didn't ask a name or anything. The text just says, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God, who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." And Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." And the woman said, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't be thirsty again. I've come here to draw water." The first point today that I want to share with you is that my source of refreshment is Jesus. My source of refreshment is Jesus. Notice a couple things in the text of who's initiating at this time, that Jesus notices her. Jesus sees her, Jesus approaches her, and Jesus asks her a question. Now, as I study this text, I'm pretty sure that this is the cliff notes of the encounter. I'm sure that it didn't start, "Girl, give me some water." I'm sure that that's not how our Lord and Savior started it. And as we get in the text, you'll find out why I said that. I believe there was an extended conversation that happened here, but the most important thing that John let us know is that there was a need, and Jesus said, "Give me a drink of water." This was scandalous because as a Jewish man, you weren't to be associated with women in public. Ladies, I love you in the Lord, but you wouldn't have wanted to live back in this day. There was no Oprah Book Club and empowerment meeting. There was no, "This is what we do as ladies." There was no "Speak up and be strong and own your identity." This was not that day, because in this day, women didn't even have rights. Women were less than property. And Jesus, in this moment, steps in and honors and says to this woman, "Give me a drink." I just love that Jesus takes the time to go places that other people refuse to go. I'm so glad that Jesus didn't look at her reputation and who she was and said, "I can't go and hang with her. She's not a member of my tribe. We don't roll like that." Jesus said, "Give me a drink." It was a simple question, but it had major implications. And I could imagine the three questions that probably were going through the mind of this woman. Who is he? I mean, seriously, who do you think you, who, what are you doing stepping to me? You're a man, you're not supposed to talk to me like this. But the second question is even more powerful. What is this gift of God that he's talking about? What is this gift of God thing? What is that? And the third one is, what is living water? What is living water? It's interesting, as I look at this text, the more things change, the more things stay the same. This first area of the passage, she brings up that issue of ethnicity and race. Now, there's these social barriers that are between us. There are these economic barriers that are between us that would keep you from being with someone who looks like me. I speak about that because I think it's significant in this text, and it's significant for us. As I look around this room, I see black, white, Indian, Asian, international. I'm so glad that in 2019 that I'm preaching in a place where there are people from all different backgrounds and nationalities. Let's give God praise and thanks for his goodness in this place. It's often the stranger, in my opinion, who most often is the easiest to love for me. But sometimes it's the people who I know the best who I struggle to love. This woman didn't know Jesus personally, but she definitely knew what it meant to be Jewish. She definitely had a preconception of who he was and what he was about. And frankly, Jesus had some thoughts himself. And he says, if you knew who was offering you a drink, you would have responded differently. Before we throw shade on the lady, let's just pause and acknowledge that she had no idea who she was talking to. Can we acknowledge the fact that she didn't know who Jesus was and what he was bringing to the table? I don't know about you, but I'm just going to talk about myself. It's a difference between being stupid and being ignorant. Being ignorant means you don't know, Terry, what's going on. You have no idea. Being stupid is Ed Ollie territory. You know what you're supposed to do, and you don't do it. Honey, I need you to stop by the store and get some milk before you come home. Okay, honey. Guys, don't leave me out here. Finish up the meeting. I've had a great time with Pastor Jason. We've been kicking it. We're at Top Golf, having a great time and just going to get gas and just doing all my other things. And I end up showing up at home, and what you think my wife's going to ask me? Where's the milk? Where is the milk? I don't care about what happened with Pastor Jason. I don't care about how the Lord met you. I just want to know, did the Lord meet you to remind you to bring some milk? No, honey, he didn't. He did not remind me to bring some milk. It's interesting, the observation of the text, that she notices that Jesus is absent, something that most people have when they come to a well. Jesus didn't have a jar. What are you doing here, and what are you going to be drawing this water with, sir? Do you have a clue what happens at wells? Are you trying to talk to me? I mean, I don't know what's going on here. A man, 12 o'clock here, no jug. We have a problem, ladies and gentlemen. And she says, where's your jar? What are you going to draw with? Have you ever been thirsty? Have you ever really, really, really been thirsty? I love that Jesus teases with curiosity to tell her, there is water I have that you don't know about. I had the privilege, I know some of you guys are looking at me and like, man, where does he get his great figure and stays in such great shape? And, you know, I really appreciate that. I want to be humble and receive that this morning. But it was a few years ago that I ran the Chicago Marathon. And the photo that you see is not at mile 21. Right around mile 6 or 7, I decided to pose for those that were watching the marathon and just felt really good and really excited, but I was getting thirsty. And, you know, sometimes when you get thirsty in the summertime, Coke is it. I mean, you just reach for a nice cold Coca-Cola. It's just a real thing. I mean, you really love Coca-Cola. But I will tell you, in that moment, it was the furthest thing that I was thinking of is Coca-Cola. I was running for clean water with Team World Vision. And you see to the right my coaches that walked with me during that whole time and trained me during the 9 months getting ready for the marathon. And I started the race thinking about the grace of God and how we were raising upwards of $1 million for clean water for children in Africa. Around about mile 16, I was thinking about how much I hated children in Africa. I was thinking about how I could have wrote a check and gave a donation and had my behind on the side cheering for all those people. But no, I'm up in a race running around Chicago like an idiot. But why? Because I believed in something that was greater than me. I was thirsty. But that didn't solve my issue in the race. I needed some water. I'm sure that this sermon has been preached a million times, and I'm sure the same analogy has been used. I'm sure that some pastor has grabbed some water and just taken a drink. Oh, that's so good. Wow, that's really good. That's really... Oh, shoot, that's really good. Oh, that's really good. I'm telling you, during the race, when you walk up and you find water and you just throw it on yourself, it just is so refreshing. And Jesus said to her, if you knew what water I have, you wouldn't thirst again. He wasn't talking about the refreshing water that she thought he was talking about. Look at Psalm 42, verse 2 for me, just one moment. Psalm 42, verse 2. I love how the Bible sheds light for us. We don't have to go looking for the truth. The truth is right in front of us. My soul thirsts for God, Psalm 42 and 2. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? Who is this person that gives this type of refreshment? Go over to verse chapter 63, verse 1. The Bible says, oh God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My soul thirsts for you. I want to ask you a question. As she was still missing the point and it's becoming clearer to us, what do you thirst for? What do you thirst for? I live in the land of milk and honey downtown Chicago. People don't have to thirst for much of anything. They just get up and get it. They take 3 or 4 steps and they have a source of water. They take a block and they're in a gym, and they take another block and they are in some of the best stores and restaurants that money can buy. They don't thirst for much of anything. And I wonder if for us in the body of Christ, if our complacency as we come to worship the Lord is often because we don't thirst anything, we don't need anything, because we have everything that we believe that we need. I don't know what she was thinking about, but the Bible lets us know the one thing she was thinking about was lightening her load. She was tired of carrying water. If you got this living water that's never going to thirst again, let me know, because I don't want to have to come to this place every day to get water. I think it's interesting that most people don't talk about who's missing in the text. She came by herself. The question is, who was responsible for helping and caring for her? Who was the man that was supposed to be there to help and comfort and secure and help her feel what it means to be content? In a moment, we're going to find out that there is great tension in this text. And I want to submit to you that the second point, that my awareness of sin is the start. My awareness of sin is the start of my refreshment. This is when the story gets hard for me. I believe questions make us uncomfortable, but they reveal the depths of our soul. Have you ever been asked a question you were afraid to answer? Honey, what do you want for dinner tonight? That's not fear, that's an inconvenience. Sometimes you don't know what to say. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about, have you ever been asked a question that you know that the answer is going to reveal your heart? Did you cheat on your taxes? Have you been faithful to your spouse? Are you emotionally in an affair with someone else? Do you really want to follow Jesus, or do you want to do what you want to do? One of the things in counseling that's crazy is how questions are so difficult to answer the more simple they become. I can be in theory about things, but when someone asks me a question directly, I got nowhere to go but to tell the truth. His question was specific, it was personal, it was detailed, but it exposed the condition of her heart. Let's read those four verses, picking up at verse 16, 15. He said, the woman said to her, sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water. And Jesus said to her, go call your husband and come here. Uh-oh. The woman answered him, I have no husband. And Jesus said to her, you're right in saying I have no husband. For you've had five husbands, and the one that you're with right now is not your husband. What you've said is true. And the woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you're a prophet. Our fathers worshiped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship. I love this quote by Professor Ryan Griffith. He says that for Christians, confession of sin is ultimately the application of the gospel. That in this one moment, Jesus asks a question that exposes everything in her heart. It's all good. Where's your husband? I don't know if you guys noticed in Scripture before that there were six. What is it that she was looking for love in all the wrong places? What is it that was her desire? I really believe that one of the things for her was security. Anybody that's married that many times, it's not just about love. It's about security and wanting to be in a safe place. And I don't know what the situation was for the guys that are here, so I'm not throwing shade only on the lady. I'm interested in talking with the five, six guys back in town of what was it that caused this, the discussion that she found herself in, but six people and the man that she was with currently was not her husband. Jesus has a way of knowing us that's incredibly uncomfortable. I find that in the world today, especially in the church, that we don't really have an appreciation of the power of sin. It's really interesting. We think that sin is an inconvenience or a mistake. you know, Pastor Ed, I made a mistake. I made a mistake. No, it didn't make a mistake. What I did is I said that God wasn't enough to satisfy me. What I said is that God is not my Lord and Savior. He's not the one who refreshes me. The Bible lets me know in 1 John 1:9 that if we confess our sins, and then it gets really good, he is what? He's faithful. He's faithful to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Jesus asked her a question and gave her an opportunity to just simply tell the truth. Over the last few months, we've had so many different things in our church that have happened. And for me, it's really interesting. I'm very clear. All we have to do is just tell the truth. Just tell people the truth. Don't sugarcoat it. Don't go around it. Don't make it up. Just tell people the truth. Something happens when you tell the truth. You get healing. You get refreshment. You get restoration. But when you conceal and when you hide and you give half truth, you can't be healed. Amen? Jesus is trying to restore her, and she makes the choice to not fully disclose. But as I read this story, she says, "Sir, I perceive that you're a prophet." Don't you love that? I don't look negatively at her. You know what I think is beginning to happen? Her eyes are starting to get open. She doesn't believe yet that he's the Messiah. She doesn't believe that he is the Lord of all creation yet, but her eyes are beginning to come open, and she says, I perceive that you're a prophet. Why? She's going to let us know in a little bit. But Jesus doesn't mix up my story with your story, Hugo. And he doesn't mess up my story with your story. He's very, very clear. And he does something that he doesn't and has not done to anyone else at this time. He reveals who he is. He says, "I am he." I'm so glad that Jesus changes everything. When you encounter Jesus, he changes everything. Verses 21 to 27 say that Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem you will worship the Father. You worship what you don't know, but we worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is a spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." This is critically important, my friends, because in this point in time, she moves and deflects from being revealed to going into a slightly theological conversation. Don't you do the same thing when sin comes to the door? Somebody really gets close to me and I'm just, "Well, you know, I don't know about predestination. What do you think? What kind of, really? We're talking about the fact that you don't have your husband here." And she asks a question that's very important, that if you do some study, where she was talking about place matters. She was still saying that this mountain where we worship is the place where you meet God. And Jesus was saying, "Really appreciate that, but the time has come where this physical place, this mountain that you're talking about, is not the issue. The issue is your heart. God is a spirit, and those that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." I love John 14:6. If you just scroll over real quick to John 14:6. Because later Jesus reveals more of himself. As he's talking with Thomas, Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, there it is, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Jesus was making it clear that God, the Father, is the destination, but you're going through me. I am truth. I am life. I'm the water that I was mentioning earlier. And then he says that I am he. The woman said to him, I know that the Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. And Jesus said to her, I speak to you. I am him. I love that Jesus not only loves us, but my worship of God is the response that he's looking for. My worship is what he's looking for. He's not talking to her about a mountain. He's not talking to her even about her husbands. He's talking to her about her heart. And he's concerned, do you understand what I really want from you is true worship? I want to be the greatest thing in your life. I want you to think about me and be truly satisfied. I want you to take a drink of me and understand that there is nothing in your life that could be substituted for the greatness that I can bring to you. It was about worship. And then I'm going to read this last part, 27 through 42, before we land the plane this morning. Just then, his disciples came back. I love the disciples. I would love to act out this part of the text right here. It would be so much fun. The disciples come back, and they marveled that he was talking with a woman, but no one said, what do you seek? Or why are you talking with her? I love the disciples at least had some sense. They were curious, but they not dare were going to ask Jesus, what's up, what is going on? So the woman left her water jar, and went away into the town. Just pause right there. Pastor Quentin got so excited this morning. He said, Pastor Ed, this is my favorite part of Scripture. So why is that? When we get to this verse that she left her jar and went back into town, the text doesn't let us know why she left so quickly. I don't know. Maybe she saw the men and thought, I could be in trouble. I could be stoned. This could be terrible for me. But the Bible lets us know that she left her jar, the very thing that she came for, and she rushed back into town. Why did she rush back into town? Verse 29, come see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ? That's why I said it wasn't a quick conversation. I think there was a dialogue that happened. I think Jesus shared a few other things about her too. Can you imagine meeting with someone? You know, yeah, your sister's Terry. Yeah, I met her. Yeah, I know who she is. Yeah, y'all grew up over here. You went to this school. Actually, her husband's name is Jason. They have three kids. Yeah, I actually know that. Oh, yeah, she's very stylish. I do know that about her. Yeah. In fact, I know her mom and dad. And this is where it's a bit. And you're just sitting there, you go, who is this? What is going on? How do you know that about me? What's going on? You got to stop. This is getting weird. And she went back into town, and she told everybody that she met Jesus. Verse 30, they went out of town, of the town, and were coming to him, they being the people. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, bruh, it's time to get something to eat. You're tired. But Jesus said to him, I have food to eat that you don't know anything about. So the disciples said to one another, has anyone brought him something to eat? I love the disciples. Where's the Chick-fil-A? Come on, guys. Peter, I told you, man, get the food. He's hungry. And then Jesus says in verse 34, a verse of clarity, Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me to accomplish the work. Do you not say, there are yet 4 months when it comes to harvest? Look, I tell you, look up your eyes and see the fields that are white in the harvest. Already the one who reaps is receiving wages and gathering fruit for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may rejoice. For here the saying holds true, one sows, another reaps. And I sent to you to reap for which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor. And if you're sitting there in the midst of this text and your mouth is wide open going, what? The disciples were too. And many theologians who've studied this have as well. We don't know if it was the people who were coming and he's going, look, guys, look at the fields are white and right. Jesus could have been looking at a desert just talking. We don't know. What we do know is that Jesus had in his mind the future and the need of the present, that these people who are coming, they're looking for something. They're looking for something that I have. It's this living water that I've told you about, because point four is my witness for God is the result of my refreshment. My witness for God is the result of my refreshment. Because Jesus changes everything. And Jesus wanted the disciples to know, I'm the reason why that they're coming. And as our worship team comes up, I want to let you know that the Deerfield Road area will not say yes to Jesus until people who have said yes to Jesus start telling them about Jesus. I love that she didn't wait. She didn't have to take a panel or to get permission. She just told her story to come see a man. And the Bible tells us in the last three verses where we're going to end today, it says, many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony, and he told me everything that I've ever did. So the Samaritans came to him and asked him to stay with him. And listen to this. He stayed there 2 days, and many more people believed because of his word. They said to the woman, it's no longer because of what you said that we believe. For we have heard it ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world. I think some of us are living off of somebody else's testimony. We've heard that God's good for somebody else, or my mom and dad, and you know, I just follow Jesus because of what I heard. But it's impossible to encounter Jesus Christ and not tell someone else. It's impossible to experience this life change and what has happened and not tell someone else. And my friends, I'm praying for each and every one of us as we close this worship service. I'm praying that the Lord Jesus would give us the boldness and the courage to be able to tell someone else about him. Amen? That is what my prayer is. It's not a prayer for Harvest Bible Chapel. It's not a prayer for me personally. It's a prayer for all of us that we would say yes to Jesus Christ and we would let him be the Lord and Savior of our lives. So what am I praying for this morning? I'm already praying about Lollapalooza 2020. I'm praying that we would cancel our services at the cathedral and meet down at Palooza and have a worship service at 10 o'clock. The worship for them doesn't start till 11. But I want to invite everybody that comes to town and everybody that's in town to come see a man and tear up Grant Park and be able to worship the Lord Jesus Christ, to let them know who he is, who he is in my life, and why he loves Chicago, that Jesus is for us. Amen? Let me pray. Father, thank you so much for your word in John 4. And I'm so humbled, God, to be able to see this woman who said yes to you. We don't know, God, even if she repented fully of her sins and came to you. She just went and told what happened to her. Let it be so, God, with us, that you are the author and finisher of our faith. You give the fruit, and we will forever worship you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and worship the Lord Jesus in response.